Welcome to the Four Corners 912 Project discussion on rules of the game. For a country to exist peaceably as a unified people in the game of life, we all must be playing by the same rule. The rules for our country were established in the Constitution that was agreed upon to abide by. This was and is the supreme law of the land.
To follow the rules, you must know what they are. They are few and clear. We hope to help you all to better understand what the rules are as we are looking to elect new representatives in local and state government offices next year.
They take an oath to uphold the constitutions of both the state and the United States.
What are they to uphold and protect?
We will begin this regular discussion beginning with the Bill of Rights, which is the first 10 amendments of the Constitution.
Welcome to this session of the Rules of the Game, put on by our 912 group here in Cortez. As we look at a Bill of Rights, is what the people are entitled to against every government on earth. Today we'll be looking at Amendment Number 9. Bud, let's have it.
Really simple and short. The enumeration in the Constitution of certain rights shall not be construed to deny or disparage others retained by the people.
Certain rights?
Yep. Amendments 1 through 8 list specific rights. The right against, search and seizures. You have to have a warrant, all that there stuff. And those are specific declarations of specific rights that the government can't intrude on. But it's not exhaustive.
Why don't we list them all?
It would be impossible to list them.
Okay.
Because we are, remember the Declaration of Independence, we are endowed by our Creator with certain unalienable rights. God didn't list them. How could we?
Okay, well, what are we getting out of Amendment Number 9 then? That makes up the extras?
Makes up for all the extras, and so does Amendment 10 when we get to it. It's kind of different, but along the same idea that this Constitution and what it lists as government authority and what it lists as government controls, especially the Bill of Rights, is not all inclusive. That there are many other rights that we have that are not listed. And the problem with that might be somebody has to decide. So a lot of this stuff winds up in the courts, whether you have a right or not. And later on today, we'll chat about that a little bit.
Well, maybe it'd be helpful to me and maybe the guys out here is how did this come about? What's the history of Amendment Number 9?
Well, there are two histories. One is ancient history. The other is a more modern history. So the ancient history is that until our Constitution, the overwhelming majority of the governments of the world were monarchical, and the people were subjects. They were owned by the king. Their rights, if any existed, were defined by the king. If he said yes, fine. If he said no, no rights. Little pockets of representative forms of government, and that is to say that the people were citizens, participants in their own rule has existed for millennia, although in little limited pockets, all the way around the Middle East and up through Eastern Europe and Western Russia into Scandinavia and even over into Greenland with the Vikings. And so it's always existed, but very small pockets. Everybody else was a subject. And so that's kind of the long form history. And then along comes 1776, where we declared that we are no longer subjects of King George III, but we are citizens of our own state and of our own country, and especially with emphasis on the state. They considered themselves citizens of the state first, and secondarily citizens of the United States.
Correct me if I'm wrong, but at that time, those people, you said states, they were declared themselves sovereign states.
Correct. They did. And that's in comparison to the federal government. Mm-hmm. The federal government was not created as a sovereign entity. Now, it's granted certain limited sovereignty in foreign affairs, treaties, and that sort of thing. But that's about it, yeah, insofar as, because you have a level of sovereignty. The only sovereign in its fullest definition is God.
True.
When he creates us, we are then granted part of his sovereignty. We can be self-directed. He gave us free will. We form a government somewhere of some form. I surrender part of my sovereignty to that governing body. So you have a declining power of authority and sovereignty as you go higher in the hierarchy of government. Okay? And so the states literally withheld most sovereignty from the United States, except in foreign affairs. And that's almost exclusively the president's domain. He has what they call plenary power in foreign affairs. Treaties have to be ratified by the Senate. The Senate can alter them and resubmit them, things like that. But the president negotiates these treaties. Plenary power to do that. And there's a book called The 5,000-Year Leap that really goes into depth in what this was all about and how we got to where we are today. Good book.
Well, when they were putting all the Constitution together and they come up with Amendment number 9, there was obviously a lot of discussions about it. Some of them thought we needed it, some of them didn't think we needed it. Kind of enlighten us a little bit how that discussions all went, why we ended up with Amendment number 9 at all.
During the ratification process of the Constitution, each state had its own ratification convention, and they argued in and out and all that stuff. And they commenced to call themselves Federalists and Anti-Federalists, which is actually backwards, because the Federalists were, okay, let's define a term. Federalism is a collection of state governments agreeing to what we call, you know, the limited power of the general government, which is what they called it. They didn't call it the federal government back then. They called it the central government or the general government. But anyway, so there was a faction that wanted a very strong general government with a very strong, almost approaching a monarch president, Alexander Hamilton and James Madison and John Jay and those guys. But they called themselves Federalists. They weren't. They were nationalists. Strong federal government. What we now call the anti-federalists were actually the federalists because they were real strong on states' rights. And they wanted to retain power as much as possible to the states and surrender as little as possible to the federal government.
Maintaining this sovereignty of the states.
Correct. Sovereignty remained in the states. Almost all authority remained in the states. So those were what we call now the anti-federalists. And the federalists called themselves federalists. The term anti-federalist wasn't meant as a compliment in those days. So the argument was the federalists, using their term, thought that the Constitution was sufficient. It gave the authorities in Article 1, Section 8, that's all we needed, and if there was nothing in there that infringed on somebody's rights, we didn't need a Bill of Rights because there was no authority for them to do it in the first place. And the anti-federalists said, not good enough. We know that all governments can be abusive, and we need to put restraints on them, and we're not ratifying this until we get a guarantee for a Bill of Rights. And so that was the huge argument, and it raged. These people got after one another. The anti-federalists were Patrick Henry and Richard Henry Lee and Robert Yates, those folks. During the Virginia Ratification Convention, there was an argument between James Mason, I think it was, and Patrick Henry. And James Mason is saying, well, this and that and the other thing, because he was a Federalist. And so he's saying, well, the Constitution means this. You know, those, even though it's not written in there, that's what it means. Patrick Henry says, if that's what you mean, sir, write it down. And that was his argument against the Constitution without the Bill of Rights. And the Bill of Rights came mostly out of Virginia. All of the states participated more or less, but Virginia already had a the basis for the Bill of Rights that we have now. So that's kind of what that argument there was all about.
Okay, so we ended up with the listing, which really is in the first eight amendments.
First eight. Mm-hmm.
So now we come to the Amendment 9, and they're still arguing about, well, we write them down, and is that going to limit us to just those?
And that was, again, part of the argument, yes.
And so then our government, the central government, then is going to assume all the rest of, if it's not written down, they're going to assume it. So along comes number 9, which does what?
It says, that ain't all.
It ain't all.
That ain't all, folks.
You go back to where the whole basis is, it limits the government. Specifically, earlier on, says the central government can do nothing that is not specifically enumerated to it. We are not specifically limiting the rights of the people. Mm-hmm. They're open. If it's not to the government, it's to the people.
It's to the people.
In fact, I think there's some quote here, all power is originally vested in and can consequently derived from the people.
The people.
Not the government. So as I see it, number nine limits the government to, you've got what you've already listed what you've got.
Mm-hmm.
All the rest of them is the people and the states.
And they're undefined.
Yeah.
Because it would be, and that was part of the argument for Amendment number nine. How could we possibly devise a list of all of our rights?
Hasn't this been turned around? I think we were talking earlier about specifically some instances where some of our government officials have said, well, if it doesn't prevent us from doing it, doesn't specifically say I can't do that, mm-hmm. our central government therefore can.
Our former president said that. Our most recent past president actually said that. If the Constitution does not deny us, we are free to act.
Well, that's backwards to me.
Backwards.
If it doesn't deny the people.
Yep, because the Constitution was meant to be a limited grant of authority, or a grant of limited authority, I should say. And so those kinds of politicians turn it on their head because they are nationalists. They are not federalists. And they can claim federalism all day long. They're not. Mm-hmm. And one of the unfortunate things we've seen in the last recent history is the states are going along with it. The states are little more than administrative areas now.
That's right.
Whatever the federal government wants to do, as long as the state gets a grant.
Of its own money.
Of its own money in the first place, then they're willing to go along with it. Yeah. And the whole political system has turned all this stuff plumb on its head.
Real quickly, this is also this has been used in this particular amendment in some past issues dealing with the 14th Amendment.
Mm-hmm. We talked earlier, I think back in our first or second session, we brought in the idea or the words emanations and penumbras.
Yeah, those are big words.
Remember that?
Yep.
We had us a time with that, didn't we? Okay. That comes out of the 9th Amendment coupled with the 14th Amendment. Now, the 9th Amendment says there are a whole lot of rights out there that we didn't list. Mm-hmm. Kind of what it says.
Right.
But to use it to degrade society is a bad thing. We have used the 9th Amendment with certain phrases out of the 14th, and maybe down the road we'll get to that, to authorize killing babies.
It's my right.
It's my right to kill my baby. We're ignoring the proscription against murder, mm-hmm. so that we can find an emanation from the 9th Amendment that says it's okie dokie to do that. And there were other cases that derived from the 9th Amendment in that tone, Lawrence versus Texas. The most recent one, to a lesser extent, was the Obergefell decision here, 2, 3, 4 years ago, whenever that was. Anyway, and you see, once this precedent of emanations and penumbras gets into the mind of the jurists, our Supreme Court, they are so locked into precedent that they don't even think. They don't read this stuff except from the perspective of precedent. So if the precedent says this, some bunch of old guys 100 years ago or 50 years ago thought this was the case, well, we have to go along with that. Unless we can find a loophole in the Ninth Amendment to expand the penumbras and emanations to this, okay murder.
That's also what you hear today. You can come up with any number, but one we've been hearing recently is my right to health care.
Mm-hmm.
You don't have a right to somebody else to pay for you.
There's the difference, isn't that? Nobody can argue that we don't have a right to health care.
You have a right to seek your own health care.
I have a right to walk up here to the hospital.
That's right.
That does not mean that you have to pay for my visit.
Mm-hmm. Get this all messed up.
All messed up. Yeah.
Well, is there any more on the ninth? Are we going to?
Well, and something that occurred to me last night, and we mentioned it when we first started, and I think it's time to bring it in again. You and I are not lawyers. We are not.
Sure not.
We are not constitutional authorities. Nope. Although I think we do a better job than a lot of those authorities, because we can read it,
yep.
And we do read it
black and white
instead of pretending yep. what it's anyway. So our effort here is not to be instructive to whoever is watching. It is to be an impetus. If you're interested in this stuff, we're just trying to give you a few hints, a few pointers of where to start, and especially on the historical side, there is a whole lot of interest in reading out there mm-hmm. about the Constitution, the Constitutional Convention, the ratification conventions, and the really heated arguments that went on then. And you can read the quotes. Who was the Secretary of Madison, mm-hmm. Madison's notes.
Mm-hmm.
You read some of that stuff, and you'll be like, how in the world them people keep from shooting one another? Because they really would. Ben Franklin was kind of a, you know, I mean, George Washington was the presiding officer, but Ben Franklin was right up there, too. Ben Franklin called a halt to the discussion. He says, we're getting too heated. Instead of all this here arguing, we need to be praying. So they took a couple of days off to pray and settle down a little bit. We think politics is nasty today. And people knew how to get after it, too.
Well, that brings the point up. As we look into elections coming up this whole year, we've got a lot of offices being up for re-election. And when we get selecting who is going to be the best for the office, do they understand what the rules of the game are? Do they understand the Constitution? The founders didn't agree on everything.
That's right. They
and
didn't.
So as we elect, do we agree on it? Because our people that we elect into office, they make a choice. They choose to abide by the rules of the Constitution of the state of Colorado.
Is that called an oath of office?
You know, I think that works.
Something
that works pretty good. Yeah.
Is that it?
Yeah.
That's agreement
the
to go by?
That is their agreement.
I see.
I will abide by mm-hmm. the rules. They make a choice.
They make a choice.
And do they understand the choice they're making?
Probably not.
Well, they haven't been a lot of them.
That's right.
But so we have to understand what the rules are to know how to interrogate them for, you want me to vote for you?
Mm-hmm.
What are you going to, give me freebies, or are you going to follow the Constitution?
And that gets right to our purpose that I was trying to indicate there, that we're providing little seeds for people, where to look some of this stuff up, how to read it in its original context so that the voter can then ask these questions of the candidates and know whether the answer is a correct one.
True.
That's a big thing right there, you know, because, boy, he's a United States senator. He must know what he's talking about. No.
Okay. Well, as we look forward to next week, the next session of this, one of the things to remember is Article Amendment 10. Mm-hmm. That will be coming up. The powers not delegated to the United States by the Constitution. That's our central government.
That's our general government.
Nor prohibited by it to the states are reserved to the states, respectively, or to the people.
Or to the people.
In other words, the government doesn't get it all.
Uh-huh.
So, gentlemen, we hope to see you next time as we look into Amendment number 10.
Toodaloo.
Filled with moments. Moments we share with those we love, worry about, and strive to protect the most. At Woodman Life, we provide insurance and retirement products to help protect you and your family so that you can enjoy all the moments to come.
Ha 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 ha!